Hey guys, this is David Osorio, head coach and owner of CrossFit South Brooklyn. We're here with this Inside the Affiliate series to talk about the what, why, and how we do things at our gym that have allowed us to be as successful as we have over the last 10 years. Our goal for you guys is to take this information, steal it, make it your own, and make it better. Hey guys, so today we're going to talk about some class management strategies. So, what are we talking about? These are basically the tools and strategies for running efficient CrossFit group classes. At CFSBK, we've been doing this for over 10 years now. We have upwards of 900 plus members at this point. So it's really important for us to make sure that we run all our classes in a really efficient, effective, and safe way. So today, I'm going to talk about some of the strategies that we've learned and that we think are most important that will help you run classes as best as possible. So why is this important? Well, it really comes down to professionalism. Good coaching is not enough. Good programming is not enough. Your job as a CrossFit group class coach is to run every single person in that class through a safe, efficient, clear, and fun workout. It's got to be safe in the context of people are not on top of each other, swinging kettlebells into someone else's face. It's got to be efficient that you get through all your programming within that hour, including any warm-up prep, skill time, whiteboard briefs, etc. It's got to be clear for the athletes. They have to know what's expected of them, know where they're going to be in the workout, and it's got to be fun. If you're too worried about how you're going to run all these people this workout, if it feels like hoarding cats, it's not going to be fun for anybody. At the end of the day, it comes down to focus. If you have strategies and a framework for how to run your CrossFit group classes that you can apply to any class regardless of the programming, the coach can focus on that good coaching, they can focus on administering the programming, and the athlete can focus on performing, working the skills, and getting better, not about where they're going to be or how they're going to run the workout. All right, so let's get down to it. How does this all work? So I think it actually starts before the group class even begins with the greeting. This is particularly important for people who are transfers, who are new members, who are visitors, people that might not know the flow of your gym yet. So as someone comes into your gym, what you don't want them is to be walking around the room, trying to find out who to talk to, figuring out where they should put their stuff, if they should warm up on their own. We've all had an experience where you walked in some sort of business and been ignored, and that's one of the worst things you can do for your members. People are already a little bit vulnerable coming into the gym, so if they're coming in and they don't feel like they're really supported from the beginning, they're not gonna be sure what to do, and they're coming in with a level of apprehension. So be proactive about that. We have a front desk at CFSBK. The second someone comes into the gym, front desk greets them, tells them what's expected of them, tells them where to put their stuff down, where they can stretch out if they want to. If you don't have a front desk, you have to be really proactive, okay? So that coach can identify the person who maybe they don't recognize that face, go over, say, hey, we're gonna start the class in about 5 minutes. You can put your stuff down, get yourself loose. We're gonna go through a warm-up, so on and so forth. Different CrossFit gyms run different ways, so it's really important to set that guidance in the beginning of the class so people know how they can start the class successfully. Which leads us to our next point, start on time. Every single class needs to start exactly when it's scheduled. At CFSBK, we're sticklers for that. The 8 o'clock start class starts at 8 o'clock, the 10 o'clock class starts at 10 o'clock, not 10:02, not 10:05. People are paying a premium to be at your gym, whether it's $150 a month or $300 a month, and the very least you can do is start the classes on time. Every second, every minute that you're going over where people are sitting around waiting when the class is going to start, perceptually they're thinking that they're getting less value for their time. They made it their priority to get there on time, to be ready for class, and if you're not taking that seriously, they don't feel like they're being taken seriously. So again, you want to run a really efficient business, you want to make sure that people have a sense of pride and predictability when they come into your gym. When you're starting classes late, they're not going to have that. Start on time, no ifs, ands, or buts. If one class is running over, pull the next group in. Maybe you brief what the warm-up is going to be, maybe you send them on a run, maybe you do some movement prep in the corner. Do whatever you can, at least communicate with them to know that when the class is going to start. You don't want people shuffling their feet around, asking what's going on. So now that your class has started, what's next? At CFSBK, we always start our classes with some movement prep and the question of the day, the QOD. Basically, we get in a big circle, we start doing some shoulder rolls, ground-based mobility, whatever kind of movement prep we think is appropriate for the day's programming. But we also do a question of the day. We've talked about this before, but this is important, not in the sense of just kind of creating community, but also, again, managing the class efficiently. So when I have that question of the day, it might be a question like, what series are you watching right now? Or name something that's overrated, or the last book you read, or last place you went on a vacation. But what that does, it allows the coaches and each person in that class to have an individual connection. You have a little FaceTime with that person, you break the ice a little bit, that person gets their name out there, it helps other members get to know each other. and it lets you learn people's names. So as we're going around, if it's a bigger class, we'll often take a little whiteboard and write people's names down as we go through. So that new person, or maybe that person that's been coming to class for a couple weeks and you just don't remember their name, it's much easier to snag their name. And when you're interacting with people, it makes a big difference to use their name, okay? If I've been coming to CrossFit group class for 4 months and no one's ever said my name, I don't feel like the coaches really know me, there's gonna be a separation there. Our goal is to create that intimacy, that trust with our members, and we wanna make sure that we're taking the time to learn their names, to use their names, and that feels like, again, they're being cared for, and we're taking that extra step to make sure that we have that connection with them. It also gives you some time to assess the next steps. So when you're in that circle, say you have a massive class, 25 people show up for your class, you've got two coaches on it, you can take that opportunity while one coach is doing the question of the day, the next coach can maybe pulling out some extra racks, maybe moving some people who are doing some personal training in the area that you need to use, organizing the logistics or the flow. So just taking one step ahead of the game. All right, so again, use that movement prep to make sure that you're set up for the next part of class and you're learning everyone's name. All right, so let's talk about the whiteboard. So in every CrossFit gym around the world, there's at least one point where everyone comes up to the whiteboard, we talk about what's expected of the day. This is a big opportunity for you as the coach to lay the groundwork for running an efficient segment that follows that whiteboard segment. Most people are pretty good. They do the program and the scaling options, but one thing I don't see as often in a lot of CrossFit gyms is how long and some of the breakout logistics. So let's start with the programming first. So obviously we have to talk about what the programming is, what the intentions are for the day, but almost more importantly, what the scaling options are. These should not be ambiguous in any way, shape, or form. If we look at our CrossFit group class, you have a small number of people doing the workout RX'd. You've got some middle level of people doing some of it RX'd and some of it scaled. And then you have a whole bunch of people doing everything scaled. So it's important to know your audience in these whiteboard briefs. If you just have Fran up as written and you don't really give any context for different versions of pull-ups to do, different weight options, how that would affect the workout, you're really only speaking to a small percentage of your members. So make sure those scaling options are crystal clear and always open yourself up for questions. So after you review what the programming is, what the scaling options are, ask people, is anyone clear about anything? Or maybe after the whiteboard brief, invite them to come to you to clarify anything they might not be sure about. Also, how long that segment's gonna be. So if we're breaking out, we're about to do some deadlifts, I'm not just gonna say, all right guys, go grab some bars, and eventually we're gonna move on to the next segment. What we're gonna do is we're gonna talk to people about how long they have to complete that, and how they should be using the time. So for example, if we're doing a 15-minute segment on deadlifts, our members know they have 15 minutes, and we'll tell them use the first 7 or 8 minutes as progressive warm-ups, and then by that 7-8 minute mark, you should be getting towards your work sets. That communicates to your members exactly how long they have to do something, how they should use that time. We'll talk a little bit more about that shortly. And finally, breakout logistics. This is a really, really, really big thing. This is probably one of the things I get the most commentary on from our own members who travel to other gyms and see that they don't do this. So when I talk about breakout logistics, say let's come back to that deadlift example. If I've got 20 people in class, what I don't want to do is just say, all right guys, grab a partner and start deadlifting, okay? Put yourself in the shoes of that member. Suddenly they're looking around, who do I ask? Who's about my strength level? I don't know this person, I don't know that person. If you're someone who's a little more introverted, someone maybe who doesn't want to speak out, it's gonna be harder for you to kind of figure out what to do. Again, I don't want to put it on my members, it should be on me, the coach, to organize that. So here's what we'll do. So we'll say, okay, who's doing over 300 pounds? A couple hands go up, and then I, as the coach, can use my experience to pair people together. Okay, John, Bill, and Sue, you guys are gonna go over there and grab some space. All right, who's doing over 250? And what I can do is go down the line of some weight scales and allow people to get paired with the people that they need to be with. It's gonna be the most efficient and effective for them to load that bar, unload that bar. So if you're using racks, same thing. At CFSPK, we have all our racks labeled. So there's different numbers that correspond with the racks. So I might put three people who are doing similar weights and have similar heights in that same rack. This is absolutely huge, right? What you don't want to do is your members are scrambled about, trying to find out who to be with, trying to figure out where to go. Someone sets up on a rack, they walk over to grab weights, and all of a sudden somebody else has taken their rack. I've seen that way, way, way too many times, and again, it's just much more professional for you as a coach to manage where people are gonna be and who they're gonna be with. What that does, it takes, again, what could be 5 minutes of ambiguity and people shuffling around figuring out what to do, to 2 minutes where everyone knows exactly where they need to be, and they can, again, get right to their workout and focus on what they need to focus on. This is critical. Please, please, please do this every single class. Do not leave it up to your members. All right, so let's talk about wall timers. These are some of the most effective tools you already have in your gym for running really efficient CrossFit group classes. And they're not just for the workout. So let's go back to that example of doing the squats. We're about to break out into a squat segment. Maybe we're doing a 5x5. What I don't want to do is just say, hey guys, squat. And at some point, we're going to wrap up and we're going to get into the Metcon. What I want to do is say, hey, we've got 20 minutes on the top clock to get through this lift. That puts every single person on the same page and gives them a constant and clear expectation of how long they have to complete that segment. What you don't want is suddenly you're waiting for two people who've got two more sets where the other 18 people in class are done. That takes the control out of your hands and puts it into the whims of your members. You wanna make sure that, again, you're running that class and you have clear expectations. The clocks are perfect because everyone can see them, and as I go on through that segment, I can communicate how long they have to remind people where they need to be. There's 5 minutes left. You guys need to be almost done with your lifting segment. You probably should be in your last attempts here. And that gives people, again, that clear understanding of what's expected of them so they can get through their workout and move on to the next segment as clearly and efficiently as they can. All right, and finally, guys, closure. So just like we started in the beginning with before the class and the greeting, we want to kind of wrap things up on the back end. I've seen this happen where a class finishes, the workout kind of is done, and people are kind of lingering like, oh, is the class done? Do we have more to do? It's as little as communicating, hey guys, great work, give everybody else a high five, put your names and numbers on the board, have a great day, so on and so forth. Again, I've been in classes where the class is kind of done and people are not sure what's going on. So again, just give them that closure, make sure they know the class is done, wrap things up efficiently, all right? So I hope you guys learned some stuff today that will hopefully leverage your abilities to run effective and efficient group classes. Again, it all comes down to a lack of ambiguity, being really clear with your members about what's expected of them, and being really clear with the coaching staff as the affiliate manager, owner, about how you run classes. If you leverage all of this stuff, if you leverage your ability to run an efficient class, then again, you can focus on the coaching, you can focus on having fun, and you can make it really predictable for your members. People love predictability. Every CrossFit group class is a little bit different, but if we kind of couch that within a particular framework, there's consistency that people can look forward to, and then your members will know how to conduct themselves in class, and more you do this on the regular, classes run even more efficiently because members know what's expected of them. They can communicate to other members, hey, you've only got 5 minutes left, like we gotta move on this segment. Things like that really help. Again, we've been doing this for 10 years. These strategies are basic, but they really, really, really work, and they're really important. So hopefully you guys enjoyed this, got something out of it. Remember, take this stuff, sit down with your team, hack it, make it your own, make it better, and see what works for you. Thanks a lot.